Fierce fighting rages in the Al Zahra neighborhood of northwestern Aleppo.
Allahu Akbar! Al-Istishhadiyya al-Ula!
Opposition fighters launched a counter-offensive on government-held parts of the city on Friday. A Syrian pro-rebel media outlet announced on Saturday rebels had taken the residential suburb of Dahiyat al-Assad. In the name of Allah the Merciful, since yesterday we've taken over Dahiyat al-Assad and have liberated it entirely. We thank God for this and are now on the outskirts of al-Akademia. Activists say more than 15 civilians have been killed and 100 wounded by rebel shelling since the offensive began. State media say 7 people have died. A Syrian military source says the army and its allies have thwarted what he calls an extensive attack on south and west.
Well, a terrifying moment for passengers aboard an American Airlines Boeing 767 when the plane caught fire just before takeoff. At least 20 people suffered minor injuries in the incident at Chicago's O'Hare Airport. And the National Transportation Safety Board will now begin the investigation into what could have been an airline catastrophe. CBS News transportation safety expert and former chairman of the NTSB, Mark Rosenker, joins us now by phone. Mark, good to talk to you today.
DeMarco, good to be with you.
Do we know what started this fire? That's the big question.
At this point, we have preliminary information indicating we had an uncontained failure of the engine, which in fact then created the explosion and the subsequent fire.
You know, the fact that something like this, obviously, clearly, that it could happen is always frightening to know and to see as we look at these pictures here. How common are incidents like this one?
Absolutely very rare. Although only a year ago we saw a British Airways flight have the same type of situation, and also another independent carrier had a engine failure that created a fire. But when you put it all into perspective, 30,000 operations a day, takeoffs and landings, equaling somewhere close to 85 million takeoffs and landings since we had our last fatal accident in the United States by a U.S. carrier, and that was in February of 2009 by Colgan Airways. Now, we did have a fatal accident from a Korean carrier a few years ago. 3 people were killed on landing in that particular accident from Seoul to San Francisco. 3 people were killed. They were ejected from the airplane as a result of them not wearing their safety belt.
But obviously, planes are thoroughly checked before takeoff. How do you give the confidence back to passengers that something like this just won't happen again? Or, as you said, this is possible?
Well, it is very, very possible. But you saw the results of the incredible training that the pilots had, recognizing they had an issue with that particular engine. They aborted the takeoff. The cabin crew did the right thing in being able to expedite these people's evacuation. There were some injuries, but that's not unusual when you jump down a slide. But these were very minor issues. We're talking about since the last actual fatal accident from a U.S. carrier in the United States, 4 billion passengers have flown safely without incident.
All right, you're the expert, Mark Rosenker. Always thanking you for joining us.
You bet.
Hundreds of aftershocks have continued to hit the areas of Marche and Umbria regions, struck by Wednesday's 2 big quakes, which almost razed the villages of Ussita, Visso and Castel Sant'Angelo to the ground, leaving about 5,000 people without shelter. The Italian Institute of Geophysics has explained that the quakes were caused by the collapse of a gigantic slab of terrestrial crust that lies underneath the intersection of those regions. The slab, long about 18 kilometers wider than 10 and 9 kilometers thick, fell for over half a meter at a profundity of about 8 kilometers.
18 kilometers is not actually a very large fracture for a usual earthquakes, so we have a magnitude 5.9 in this Italian earthquakes, which has just occurred. But for larger earthquakes, such as those that occur in Japan or in Indonesia. We can have even fractures that extend for hundreds of kilometers.
On Saturday, at a demonstration organized in Rome by the ruling Democratic Party, Italian authorities explained that the government intends to rebuild and start again in the towns flattened by the August 24 and Wednesday's quakes.
Quaked regions of Marche, Abruzzo and Umbria lie in an area long known to be the most seismically hazardous in Europe. Italy has been questioned why it was so grossly unprepared for quakes.
Questo è quello che vogliamo fare ora.
We're now going to implement a long-term plan to make Italian homes safe and resistant against earthquakes. The current situation is rather complex because for years we have failed to build structures that would follow seismic code regulations.
According to experts, about 7 out of 10...
Naturalmente si discute anche della magnitudo, puoi immaginare tutte le polemiche che sono seguite e che seguiranno. Ancora c'è da dire che Norcia, centro storico, le case sono ovviamente lesionate, poi per quanto riguarda il grado bisognerà aspettare. Quello che non c'è più e che penso che voi siete ancora...
Anche una barella nel caso qualcuno abbia necessità naturalmente di aiuto. Questo noi adesso... diciamo, vedi, alcuni vengono caricati addirittura sull'auto della Polizia Municipale, sono anziani, svuotando la piazza. Viene evacuata a gruppi di 10, i vigili del fuoco accompagnano le persone, sono già uscite proprio mentre c'era la conferenza stampa.
Della Protezione Civile è attiva ed è tarata per...
Fierce fighting on the front lines of this tunnel. Even as opposition fighters launch a large-scale offensive on the government held west of the city. A number of groups are trying to break the government siege of opposition held areas.
We are fighting the regime forces on every front in the east to ensure they don't reinforce their colleagues in the west.
Until recently, Russian and Syrian airstrikes had killed hundreds in the east of Aleppo. There's a pause in those attacks and Russia says it won't restart them just yet. But the opposition fighters say they are not taking any chances. Here, children help them burn tires and keep on replenishing the fires. The smoke is meant to obscure rebel positions from the view of Syrian and Russian pilots. The offensive has been weeks in the making. The rebels have brought with them plenty of firepower. Hundreds of rockets targeting government positions. But they have just something as powerful, a new unity. And suicide car bombs in numbers far greater than before.
The rebels say they have broken through government lines and taken the Tahiyat al-Assad neighborhood, an entry point into West Aleppo. They say their next target is the al-Assad military academy, a key installation for the government.
Back in the east, opposition supporters follow the news of their advances on their phones.
We are following the news about the offensive. Our spirits are high and we will be victorious. This is a battle to liberate the whole of Aleppo.
We don't care how long it takes to get victory. We have faith in our fighters, both inside the city and those outside.
Aleppo's fate and that of Syria's civil war are joined together. And in the divided city, East and West Aleppo look the same today. Mohammed Adou, Al Jazeera, Gaziantep.